Hi, good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us this morning. Just before we begin, since we talk about foster animals, this is one of the current SPCA fosters. But today we are going to talk about puppies. So let's get right to it. We'll focus about behavior because I think a lot of times when pet owners, puppy owners bring their pet to the vet, a lot of the talk is centered around the medicine side, the vaccines, the preventive care, heartworm, fleas and ticks. And in a 15 minute or even half an hour consult, there's not enough time for us to engage with the owner to educate them about certain puppy behavior issues. So I would like to take this opportunity to share as much as I can. Most of the slides or most of the content today is by this guy called Dr. Ian Dunbar. He's a living legend in the UK. He is a vet and is also a first generation dog trainer. And then he started a serious dog training academy, and I'm also a student of a serious dog training academy. And Dr. Ian Dunbar is also the founder of Association of Pet Dog Trainers. If you ever come across his content or his books, I highly recommend them. And then at the same time, you see a QR code on the screen. This is actually some of the training content and books that I have access to and I have distribution rights to because I am part of Sirius Dog Trainer Academy. And then if you use your phone now, you can scan the link and then I'll send all the resources to you that I have. And then to be honest, once you have done this link, we can end this talk right now because that's all you need. At the end of the day, puppy training is like trying to raise a human kid in general. There's so much information. And then just to be realistic, it's impossible for me to offload everything in 45 minutes to an hour. So I'm just going to cover the main points and then a lot of the other details or the specifics or the small obstacles or the tips and tricks. If you go to that link, we'll send them all. Maybe not at one go because it can be overwhelming, but bit by bit, we'll have everything. And then, so I guess, let's look at the chat now. Can I just, everyone just type in here if you have a puppy currently or you plan to have a puppy soon? Just type in the chat just to make sure that I'm not actually talking to myself right now on Sunday morning. Anyone? Yes. Thank you so much for replying because a lot of these online webinars actually feel quite lonely, to be very honest. And then the next question is, if you have a puppy, is it your first time having a puppy or you have dogs before this? That's my second question. Yeah. So I guess a big part of this whole campaign that SPCA currently is having is organizing and pushing about teaching with kindness. I guess some people, when they are second time dog owners or they have dogs before, they think that they are good with dogs and they are good with dogs, so they don't really need to learn anything new about dog training or puppy behavior. But I do think that even for us as humans, we interact with humans for like 20 and 30 years and no one can say with absolute confidence that they truly understand human behavior. So even for us, we interact with humans and on a daily basis, there's still so much more to learn about human motivation, human behavior. And there in universities, there are entire disciplines like human resource and management, just talking about how to lead and manage people. So in the world of puppy training, dog training, it's also the same, to be honest with you. There's always new research. There is always new and better methods to interact and train with your dog. And for me as a vet, my motivation to find out more is really, let me just get 1 second to get on my pointer. Is this dog right here. La. So this is Mira. Mira was rescued from SPCA when she was 1 month old. And then this is her now. And when I was fostering Mira, I wanted, as cliche as it sounds, I want to do the best I can for her. And that's when I entered the rabbit hole about puppy training and dog training. And then trying to find out more, how can I be a better dog owner, really? And there's so much more to learn. And I hope to share as much as I can. And then as I learn more, I will share this journey with everyone else. So the topics, the main three topics today are developmental guidelines, which as puppy owners, you have a unique opportunity to train your dog, train your puppy. Once you miss those deadlines, it's a lot harder for you. And then that's the advantage of having a puppy instead of an adult dog. And then the next two things are socialization and bite inhibition, which is also very important, which I unfortunately think not enough people are talking about it. So let's see now, if you have a puppy, what's the next step? Like, yay, we got a puppy. We probably, hopefully you adopted the puppy or maybe spend a few thousand dollars on it. There's no worries. No, both are okay. And then, so the main thing about puppyhood is that it's really the most critical period of a dog's life. This period of time, when they're just born, their brain is in such a way they're still developing that they are very receptive to training, receptive to the environment. And whatever they do now can unfortunately make or break the puppy. Because like sometimes, unfortunately, some bad experiences can leave long-lasting trauma. So let's say when you're trying to clean the puppy's ears, if you were too rough, if you use excessive handling, and then you cause pain, and you inflict fear into the puppy. And then if the event is stressful enough, traumatic enough, from then on, from the rest of the dog's life, it's going to be very difficult to clean the dog's ears. So if you do it correctly, if you do it right, if you do it with kindness, you can train a puppy, train a confident puppy, and that effect will be long-lasting for the rest of the puppy's life. So let's talk about the three main developmental height deadlines. So basically what it means that there are three things, there are three traits that you as the puppy owner have the absolute advantage in training a puppy. So this is the easiest period to train. So for example, socialization of people, getting the puppy used to different individuals, different strangers. If you do it before 12 weeks of age, it's very easy. It's like a cakewalk. Simply just, you just pass the puppy around. Everyone just cuddle and hug the puppy. Oh, so cute, and just pass it around. So, unfortunate part is once you miss these deadlines, it's going to be very difficult and very challenging to train the same few traits. So for the dog to be socialized with people and then to learn bite inhibition, to be able to discuss more what exactly is bite inhibition later. And then by 5 months of age, actually, that's when the puppy is reached adolescence, and then this is when you have to prevent some of the adolescence problems that can start to happen. So talk about socialization. So you need to socialize them with humans and also dogs, especially actually. So, and then other animals, maybe be challenging, would be like cats, but you may not have access to them. So the two main important thing is humans and children. 1 second, just look at my notes and make sure that I explain everything. So this period of time is when the puppy is most impressionable. And then I've seen in a vet clinic that sometimes a particular dog is like one human dog. Basically, this dog is okay, one human. Anyone else, the dog goes a bit cray. It's fearful of other humans, angry at other humans. So you can prevent that by having a friendly dog, by making sure that your puppy interacts with as many humans as possible, especially children as well. But if you must always remember, when you let a human child interact with a puppy, it's important to be there, to be present, to supervise the whole interaction, because unfortunately, sometimes the human kid may not understand better, and then they may not know. They may not be careful. They may injure themselves or the puppy. Yeah. So the main key point is that a well-socialized puppy will grow up to be a fantastic companion. So what kind of socializing? So the main thing is you have to meet as many different individuals as possible. It's not just the five family members at home. And then the type of interaction can be handling. So just carrying the puppy, can be feeding treats, just making the experience for the puppy as enjoyable as possible. Yeah. So I guess the one common tricky part is that during this period of time, the puppy has not yet finished the three puppy vaccinations. So a lot of the vets actually recommend you not to bring your puppy out of the house, which is true because at the end of the day, the core vaccines protects your puppy against very dangerous viruses. So how do you maneuver that tricky scenario is that you keep your puppy in an indoor environment, maybe at your own home, and you invite family and friends over, or you can bring your puppy to someone else's house, whichever is more convenient for you. And the main thing is that you minimize puppy interaction with the ground, with the soil, with the external outdoors. That's what you're trying to minimize. So indoor to indoor, indoor to the car, and then car to the indoor. And then if you want to interact with other dogs as well, you have to make sure that the other dogs are vaccinated. So the next thing about bite inhibition, just maybe in the chat, just say yes or no in a sense that have you heard about this concept of a bite inhibition before? Just 1 second. I'll just wait and take a sip of my coffee. Yeah. So, bite inhibition is actually extremely, extremely important. It's basically for the dog to understand not to bite very hard. So it's the ability to control the force of their mouth thing. So basically a soft mouth is the ability to hold or bite gently. And then the key point is that with my personal experience, it's absolutely critical for the puppy to learn this before 18 weeks old. Yeah. So I guess it's not about giving another thing for the dog to bite. It's that teaching the dog when interacting with humans or interacting with other dogs, they don't bite too hard. So at the end of the day, for us, for humans, we have two hands, so we interact with the world with our hands. And then for a dog, they interact with the world with their mouth. That's how the way it is. So for cats, actually, they use their hands as much as well, but not really for dogs. So I guess let's talk about why this is important. Because the main thing is that sometimes bites are bound to happen. So basically, a few years down the road, when your dog injures himself, let's say he caught his feet somewhere and he pulled his feet, and then the nail came off. So there's injury, there's bleeding, and then you as the dog owner, you need to clean the wound to make sure it doesn't get infected. So it's painful for the dog. The dog may not understand what exactly you are doing. And then what happens is that when you try to clean a wound, then the dog reflects where there's pain inflicted onto him. He will try to defend himself. And then sometimes they will try to bite. So the thing is that you can actually train the dog such that he knows rationally that he's not supposed to bite you as the owner or human beings. And then even if he does, in a sense that he, in the moment of anger, he accidentally tried to bite you, we can also train that even if he accidentally bites, he doesn't bite too hard. So you see the advantage of training your dog how to do this. Yeah. So it's also very important if you plan to have kids or the dog is going to hang around with kids. So let's say if the dog actually, let's say one common scenario is the kid accidentally stepping on the dog's tail. So the dog was sleeping, the kid come by, step on the dog's tail, the dog got a fright, freaked out, turned around, tried to bite the kid, and even the dog. So one scenario, the best case scenario is the dog turn around and a split second recognizes, wait a minute, he's not supposed to do that, and then he freezes and stops. This is still okay. But if he accidentally beat the child, if there's a soft mouth, the child actually is just going to graze on hand or graze on the arm, and then there's no open wound, they don't need for stitches. So it's very important. It's a human safety thing. It's also safety for the dog as well. Yeah. So the main thing is, let's say if you have a litter of puppies, they naturally learn bite inhibition. So when the puppies play with each other, if one of the puppies bite too hard, the other puppy will run away. And then for the puppy that bit too hard, in his mind, he's like, oh, wait a minute, I want to play with this other puppy. And then because I bit too hard, the puppy ran away. So there's a conditioning. He realized if he wants to continue that play, he needs to make sure that he doesn't bite too hard. And then, unfortunately, if you bring the puppy home, there's no other puppies to play with your dog. Then you as a human being has to step into that role of training a puppy by inhibition. Yeah. So the main thing is that it's also important for them to have the opportunities to interact with other dogs. So a lot of the play biting may be just be play to us, but to them it's very important opportunity to learn how to interact with other dogs. So the next time when they interact with other dogs years down the road, they always remember to have to be good mannered dogs so they don't bite too hard. Yeah, so inadequate bite inhibition is quite dangerous. It's dangerous for the humans around the dog, dangerous for the dog themselves as well. So it's very important to teach them this. And then I guess the main big thing is bite inhibition training is never perfect. So there will be opportunities, there will be times where the dog actually forgets. It's a bit like humans when you're trying to learn a good habit. In the best case scenario, if we are robots, we'll do the same good habit every single day, but we are not, we're living things. And the same with your dog. There are sometimes your dog will make a mistake. It is important for you as a dog owner to correct that mistake, to help your dog remember the good behavior and the good habits. Yeah, so I guess this main point is more of like, let's say if you missed it, scenario, you miss that training period, it's going to be very, very difficult. And then, unfortunately for us at SPCA, we sometimes when we have dogs that are rescued or dogs that are abandoned, if they are older, then this critical period is a lot harder. We do see how difficult it is and how much work and effort we need to put in to train these older dogs by inhibition. So the main thing is that let's say a dog made a mistake. The success of retraining, how easy it is for you as the dog owner to make sure that your puppy remember, your dog remembers, it depends on how much they learned when they were a puppy. So this whatever you're teaching them now has a lasting impact. So I guess one second. Yeah. So this is what I've just mentioned just now. So the key thing we are focusing on is as puppies, there's extreme high learning ability. So this is a key point. So I guess the main thing about bite inhibition, I don't really have a video right here. Later I'll send a few videos about how dog trainers overseas train bite inhibition. Yeah. So the main thing about bite inhibition is also one important trait that I've learned is that when your puppy bite your clothing, let's say you wear long sleeves and your puppy bite your clothing, it's important to train a puppy not to bite your clothing as well. Yeah. So it makes sense when, let's say, so important for them to realize that actually it's wrong for them to bite clothing. So a lot of times the bite inhibition training focus on the actual human being, the hands, the legs, so you cannot bite the human. But when you teach them not to bite the clothing as well, you minimize a lot of other injuries because we have seen some injuries where the puppy actually just want to pull on the just want to pull the owner, drag the owner back. So they just nibble the pants. By then, accidentally, because now they are like a lot bigger, they are 2-3 years old. Then when they try to bite the pants, they actually bite too much. And then they actually manage to nibble the leg as well. So you have to teach them not to bite any clothing of the human being. So the best way to learn bite inhibition is actually through videos, not through a slide. So later, I'll send out some videos for people to learn how to train their dogs bite inhibition. And then, I guess a tip that I give you is just to keep trying, because sometimes it doesn't make sense at the beginning. At the beginning, it's like you just keep failing. But if you be consistent, you keep trying, after a while, the puppy gets it. So the big part of it is actually in a while when puppies play puppies, they just learn it very naturally. So what I try and do is try to simulate the environment for the puppy to learn it naturally. So at the end of the day, the puppy is incredibly smart. Dogs are incredibly smart animals. Then, so talking about adolescents, so after you taught them socialization, after taught them bite inhibition, then I guess the main thing is that one common obstacle a lot of the owners share with me is that sometimes the dog learn a bad behavior. So the main thing is that they are not robots. So a lot of things that which ongoing, there's a lot of changes. So a lot of times some things may happen that you may not like, but that's totally normal. And then there's something you can do about it. Then a lot of times socialization and bite inhibition will deteriorate when they're older. So it's important for the dog owner to step in. And then usually the behavior matures around 2 to 3 years old, and usually things get more stable then. So so there's a Chinese saying my mom used to tell me a long time ago. Is basically it means that to learn something good, you need 3 years. To learn something bad, you only take 3 days. And it's the same for the puppy as well. So it's important to be diligent as a dog owner to watch out for these bad habits. I think part of it is also sometimes you get a bit complacent. For example, we try to teach the dog not to jump onto the sofa. But then a common unfortunate error is that if you're not consistent with it, sometimes you let the dog jump on this, sometimes you don't let the dog jump on the sofa, and then it gets harder for the dog to get rid of the habit because they don't understand what's wrong. Because sometimes it's okay. Yeah. So as the dog grows older, their jaw muscles get stronger and stronger, so they can bite harder. So that's why they may have moments where they lose bite inhibition. So that's why bite inhibition training is lifelong. You as a dog owner need to be consistent. You need to let your family members know as well, because at the same time, you don't want your dog or your puppy to realize they cannot bite you, but they can bite everyone else. They need to learn that they cannot bite any human being. That's the main key point here. And socialization also deteriorates after a while. And then sometimes you can realize this is a very friendly dog. It loves all human beings. But suddenly, a few weeks later, suddenly your dog is very scared of strangers. As unfortunately, sometimes because I think when we are puppy owners, when we've just got a puppy, we are the most excited of dog ownership. We are the most enthusiastic, we are the most motivated. So you do everything you can for your puppy. But after a while, as time goes by, when you get used to having a dog at home, you have other hobbies and other things like that, then people tend to be more relaxed when coming to training your dog. So you bring your dog out less, the dog meet less human beings, meet less strangers, and then sometimes, unfortunately, socialization will be affected. Interesting thing is that this is also quite common in human kids. Like some of the kids, when they are young, they are very easygoing. Any stranger come up to them, ask them to sing, they'll sing. But then once, this is my experience, my own cousin. So then when the cousin's older, now the cousin is like on his phone the whole day. Doesn't really deal with us anymore. Yeah. So this is a very common scenario. I see at vet clinics where suddenly a dog, there's a puppy at the time was like, oh, crazy, love everyone, love the nurses, things like that. And then suddenly it's like, come to the vet clinic, so one corner is scared of everyone. It's the same dog, just a different time, different age. Yeah, so, and that's why it's very important to maintain, unfortunately, you need to maintain the discipline as a dog owner, the enthusiasm, the consistency, to make sure you continue providing the environment for your dog to thrive. So I guess big part of this takeaway is that if your dog changes behavior, do not be discouraged, because it's a common situation. Yeah. So the main thing is you need to continue what you're doing, or continue what you have been doing. Because if you want a pet dog, then you need to do those activities that is related to having a dog. At the end of the day, having a pet is for life. So you need to know this is what you sign up for in the first place. So having a dog is the big part. Having a dog is bringing a dog out for walks, bringing a dog out to meet other people, bringing a dog to the dog park to meet dogs. So that's what having a dog is about. So this is something you're going to do for the next 10 to 15 years. So yeah, so that's what I meant by if you want a dog, then you need to really be committed to doing all these activities about having a dog. So you need to continue all these things to make sure that your dog does not learn any bad habits. And then I guess this slide here is also a lot of our pet owners, a lot of dog owners that come to the vet clinic, ask them, do you have any concerns? Then the main thing they always ask me is, can I feed my dog salmon? Or can I feed my dog pumpkin? Or is it okay if I feed my dog some leftover food? So for me, I guess if you come to the vet clinic once a year and this is the question you have for me, I think there's a symptom to the much bigger problem. Because right now in Singapore, the paradigm of dog ownership, a big part of it is simply feeding the dog some food. That is the major way or main way of how pet owners bond with their dog. So there's more to pet ownership than simply giving treats. Because a lot of times, a side topic is that unfortunately, majority of the dogs we have in Singapore are obese. And then a lot of times they do feed treats through the day, and that contributes to the obesity. And then I tell the owner, why do you need to feed treats in the first place? Are you not feeding your dog the proper meals? Yes, they are feeding the dog the proper meals, but they don't feed the treats to the dog. They feel like the dog looks so sad. They don't know what else to do with the dog. But there's so much more to dog ownership than feeding food. So dog training actually is not so much training your dog. At the end of the day, dog training is an activity for the dog to bond with you. At the end of the day, dogs are extremely smart human beings. Sorry, extremely smart animals. And then when you keep them in an apartment for 8 to 10 hours a day, they have nothing much to do. And then their brain is they're trapped in this mental confined space. So much energy in this small environment. So when you do dog training, you're giving an opportunity for the dog to exercise their brain. You're giving opportunity for the dog to interact with you. And actually, a lot of dogs actually do enjoy dog training. And then for them, that is actually a better way for them to bond with you. Yeah. So to go back to continuing to socialize your dog with different people. To basically show them the world, really. It's more than just the apartment. And then I guess during Circuit Breaker, we also have a glimpse of how it's like to be at home the whole day. And then for us, we have Wi-Fi, we have Instagram, we have Facebook. But can you imagine when you go out to work and then your dog's alone at home and then they're just there. And there's no wonder why they start developing bad habits, like they chew and lick their paws or they chase their tails, because they unfortunately are just bought shit out of their minds. Yeah. So really is bring it out. Really, if you're going to have a dog, that enjoy having a dog. So it's allow the dog to go out with you. Go to, dog-friendly places. Don't break the law. And then a big part of it is also, interesting thing is also getting your dog used to going to the vet clinic. So some things you can do is actually bring your dog. If you stay near the vet clinic, just walk your dog there. Go to the entrance, ask the dog to sit, give a treat, and then you just leave. So it's just for the dog to recognize that actually the vet clinic is not a scary place. And then also an advantage to that is also you can just go inside the vet clinic, weigh your dog, and then you leave. So a lot of vet clinics, they don't charge you a single cent for that. But the advantage for you as a dog owner is you can monitor the weight of your dog as well. Yeah. And then, yes. So I guess a big part of it is that us as human beings, we have a lot of activities to do, we have a lot of hobbies and things like that. But then, as cliche as it sounds, your dog doesn't have much going on except for you. So it's important for you to devote time and attention to your dog. And then, yes. I guess this is more like a gateway training. Gateway in a sense that open up to more opportunities. So the QR code there goes to this book by Dr. Ian Dunbar about after you get a puppy. So you go to that link. The link, once again, I'm pointing at my screen, you cannot see. So this link here and this QR code is the same thing. Basically you put your email and I'll send you the, oh, one second, I think I pressed the wrong thing. Yeah, so this is the page, then I'll send you the link. Once again, I think I clicked something. Are you still seeing my screen? So anyway, and then this particular book here, Decoding Your Dog. So I put the note here about vet behavior specialist. Oh, once again. So the vet behavior specialist is a very interesting group of people. At the end of the day, once again. So this is the book right here. This computer, the screen. So if you think about psychiatrists for humans, where a medical doctor go through medical school, and after that they go through psychiatrist specialist training, and then they become a psychiatrist. So vet behavior specialists, they are the same thing, where they go through vet school, they become a vet. After that, they go to a specialization. They specialize in behavior, animal behavior. And that training usually takes 3 to 5 years. After that, there's an exam. And then the interesting thing about this particular book is published. Look at the screen, it's easier. Once again. Look at my pointer here. The American College of Veterinary Behaviorists. So this whole college is just all the specialists in the world. They unite under this college. So this particular book is actually very informative, very easy to read. And then it's scientific based. That's the main key thing. So all the specialists in the world about veterinary behavior, about animal behavior, they come together to write this book. And then unfortunately, they're academics, they're researchers. They are good at their craft, but they are not good at marketing. So that's why not enough people know about this book. And that's why I try to do my best to let people know about this book, really. The unfortunate part is because they're not good at marketing, they're not good at business. So it's hard to find this particular book in Singapore. What I did was I went to bookdepository.com to buy this book. Yeah. And then at the end of the day, for dog training, it's always easier to watch videos. So I've had some YouTube channels for you to check it out. Kiko Pup and Zach George. Zach George actually has a book as well called Dog Training Revolution. Then Zach George YouTube channel is actually quite interesting. He has a vlog series of him trying to raise a Border Collie puppy. Border Collies are extremely intelligent human puppies. They're one of the smartest ones. And then the unfortunate part is they also can be the most stubborn and hard, and then the hardest to train. So you can actually see the dog trainer himself meeting all these obstacles and how he overcomes them. So I guess it's interesting and funny at the same time to laugh at the dog trainer making all these funny mistakes. But at the same time, you realize that actually there's no one person. I mean, even dog trainers make these errors, but then they know how to overcome it. And then you realize that actually it's common for you as a dog owner to make all these mistakes. Then you actually feel like, okay, it's not too bad. And then you actually find out how you can overcome all these issues. Yeah, and it's quite entertaining, to be honest, the vlog. And then Kiko Pup is also a very, very good dog trainer overseas. Yeah. So I guess this is it. And then the main thing is that There's so much more, really. And then that's why I keep emphasizing this QR code and the link, because the actual guide, the actual book itself is a few hundred pages. And then the main thing is, I hope you're not intimidated by a few hundred pages, but at the same time, I mean, if you already committed that life decision to get a puppy, then you have to go all in, really. And then the book is actually, one, the book is free. And then the book, two, is the book is very, very informative. And at the same time, it's also question forward. There's checklists and things like that. And I think it's an absolutely brilliant resource, to be very honest with you. Yeah. And then it's very graceful that Dr. Ian Dunbar allows all his students to just share it with everyone else. Yeah. And that's about it, really. And I hope that I didn't confuse you. And then I guess the next part is we get to some questions.
Yes, thank you very much, Dr. Chow, for everything that you've shared. It's really very informative. And I think we have a lot of questions also, so we can just jump right into it. So the first question is from Max. He says, my puppy keeps licking his legs. I have checked and can't find anything on it. No insect, no wound. Shall I be concerned and shall I stop him?
Yeah, so I guess the big part of it is the main thing is always whether it's a medical reason. And if it's not a medical reason, like there's mites, fleas, infection, then the next part is think about why they are doing it. So some of the puppies that lick have two front paws. It's because they have nothing to do, and then these two things are waving in front of them, and they start licking it. So it can become a bad habit. So the next part is, I guess the next, I'm looking for things to show you all around my house. So the next part is also make sure you provide enough environmental enrichment, which is another very important topic. Once again, Captain, I'll get to show you some stuff.
Yeah, so in the meantime, I think the QR code that Dr. Chow shared earlier on is not functioning, or there's some error. So the links are posted in the chat, so feel free to access it through the links in the chat. Yeah, so we apologize for the QR code not working. For the rest, if you have questions, do feel free.
So now we're talking about. Yeah. Sorry, because no, I see me running around. So I guess big puppy is now we're not talking about puppy behavior anymore. We're talking about dog behavior in general. So you look at my screen. This is something that looks a bit weird. So two more things to show you looks a bit weird. This thing looks a bit weird, and then this thing is a bit weird. So these three things are actually food puzzles for Mira. So I actually rotate them. So the main thing is at the end of the day, look about dogs in general, historically, they are scavengers. They walk around looking for food. But then when we bring them to our home, they become pets. When it's meal times, the meal time comes, they will come to you, you put the food bowl on the floor, and then within 5 minutes, they finish the food. And then they spend the next 10 hours not doing much, waiting for the next meal time. So the idea of food puzzles is that you train your dog to work for food. So this one is actually a wobbler. So I can open it, and I put food inside, and I close it. And then what Mira does is Mira had to like sort of knock it back and forth, then the food will fall out from the hole here. And then instead of taking 5 minutes to eat, now she takes like half an hour, and then she's working for her food. So she exercises her brain as well. And then it's the same for this one. This one's a different one where there are holes. So it looks very worn up because we're using it for a long time. And then you see there's holes here, and the food will hide this green color thing. And then as Mira knocks it around, it'll go to the center. And then the keyboard that I use is actually around the same size as this hole. So it's actually a challenge for her. So the main thing is that the puppy should provide enough environmental enrichment, really. And then they minimize a lot of bad behavior issues. Yeah, so then one of the things they always say actually is to throw away the football because the football doesn't really add value to the dog ownership, doesn't really add value to the dog. Another thing is also if you want to be more cheapskate, one way is actually hand feeding the kibbles to your dogs. So that's, that in that way, that also trains by inhibition. So the dog in itself has to learn how to take the kibble off you without biting you. So they're training two things at one go. Yeah, so I guess it is a very long-winded answer to the question in a sense that you to make sure that it's not due to medical reasons and it's not due to boredom. Yeah.
Okay, thank you for that, Dr. Chow. So the next question we have is from Fabian. So he's asking, is it necessary to brush the dog's teeth every other day and how do we make it easy?
So the answer to this question is not going to be, you're not gonna like the answer because the answer is actually you have to brush the teeth every day. So even for us, we brush our teeth twice a day. And then for dogs, actually once a day, if you don't do it, is the proper way to do it. But unfortunately, life gets in the way. You work OT, you come back home, it's freaking 10 p.m. Are you still going to brush the teeth? So I guess every other day is a compromise. Every other day, every day possible. And then it's also something that's good to start when the dog is still young, when a puppy, when they get used to having a toothbrush in their mouth. Yeah, so how to make it easy is... there are flavored toothpaste for dogs. So the flavored toothpaste actually makes the dog more receptive of that. And then I guess the big part of it is also some of the dog owners that I've met, they are very wary of being near the dog's face or the dog's mouth. So that's why as puppy owners, we have the advantage of being as near as possible to the puppy's mouth as possible. Like we use a toothbrush, we use our hands, put it in the mouth, so get the puppy used to humans interacting with his or her mouth. So then that will make it easy for you down the road. And then another thing is also rewarding the dog for staying still. So you break the toothbrushing activity, the different parts. So you, let's say you brush like 3 seconds and give a treat. 3 seconds and give a treat. That's also how I train Mira to accept me cutting her nails actually. So she give me a paw and I cut her nails. And at the beginning, I cut one nail, I give her a treat. I cut a second nail, I give her a treat. And now it's like I cut the one paw, then I give her a treat. Then she realized that that's what I try and do is to condition her to realize the activity is no big deal. La. And then actually she get rewarded for staying still. Yeah. And then talk about dental chews. So dental chews in itself is a compromise, better than nothing. It doesn't really substitute. So if you're not even brushing your teeth, then dental chews would be good. Another thing that I use, let me get it. So for me, I also use something similar to dental chews. This is what you can get at the vet. So this is actually just kibble, but then in the sense that they make it in the manufacturing plant that it doesn't crumble when a dog chews. So it actually helps to scrape the teeth when a dog is chewing. And then they have it for cats too. Yeah, so I use this instead of dental chews because some of the dental chews actually they are a bit too flavorful. I mean that's why the dog likes it lah. But then this one actually is just warmer kibble. Yeah. Dental wash in itself, yes, so it does help. One second, let me just Google and show you a logo. Oh, is my screen still shared? No, right?
No, it's just on your video now.
Yeah, I'll just show you something once again. Health. Yes. So a lot of the things, right, if you need to look for a logo, let me go to the chat box to type it in. Yeah. So a lot of these dental washers and things like that, if they have the Vet Oral Health Council logo on it, actually is verified and proved that it works for the dental health of the dog. And then for me, what I realized is that sometimes you have to make sure that after you add the dental wash to the water, your dog is still willing to drink the water. Sometimes, because of marketing, they make it like means smell like mint flavor, things like that for the human, but actually the dog hates it. Yeah, so they make sure the dog actually drinks the water. Yeah.
And also, I think this is a personal question because I've fostered puppies before, and the treats when you give them, when you try to train them, is there a specific kind of treats that's advisable? Because sometimes you need to really feed a lot of treats, right?
So, yeah.
Yeah.
So for me, at the beginning, you portion out, like today I'm going to feed these two meals of kibble for Mira when she was a puppy. And then I use those kibbles as training treats. That's what I did, like, because a lot of time I realized it's so a bit hard to think. Is if you're going to, like, a 1 hour training session is like, think about all the treats that you're giving to the dog, it's insane amount. So in overseas, some of the dog or puppy training classes, actually that's what they actually recommend, where the puppy owners come in with all the kibbles they were supposed to feed as meals. And then through the 45-minute session, they just feed out the food.
And what if they're not enticed by the kibbles?
At the end of the day, even for humans, when you do things, there's a cost-benefit analysis. So for the puppy, the same thing. So a lot of times, if you're going to train something that's extremely hard for them to do, then you may need to up the ante. You may provide a different kind of treat.
Better treats. Okay.
Yeah, so it depends on the activity. So the dependent activity, the next part is also sometimes you may need to break that certain, let's say you are training a dog trick or some tricks. You may need to break the trick down into small little steps such that it's small enough for the dog to be willing to do it.
Manageable.
For keeper. Yeah, yes, exactly. Yeah. But there are sometimes, let's say you're training something versus, for example, like you're training your dog to not to chase after a rabbit. Then a kibble for sure is not
interesting enough.
Yeah, you need something else crazy, like maybe chicken cooked meat and things like that. Yeah.
Okay. Okay, thank you for that. All right, so our next question is from Jasmine. My puppy only barks when left alone in the playpen, but can sleep alone in the playpen at night. She doesn't want to play with her toys when she's in the playpen.
So I guess the concern is that when you leave the puppy in the playpen alone while you're around the house, the puppy starts to bark. Then when everyone is sleeping, the puppy is willing to sleep in the playpen. I guess when I read out the question itself, I'm not sure if everyone else have the similar light bulb moment where you realize why the puppy is barking. Because when you're at home, you're doing your things and then your puppy is just right down there in the playpen. So the puppy doesn't want that toy. The puppy wants your attention. And that's why the puppy is barking. Unfortunately, so I guess then the puppy is barking because the puppy is trying to let you know that, hey, I'm here. Why are you like watching Netflix? I'm here. So I guess this talk is about actually crate training. So being in a playpen is actually, it's very, very similar to crate training, where you're training the puppy to be inside a crate. So I guess the main thing is to do proper crate training, actually you need to make it such that being in a crate or being in a playpen is not an aversive experience. So a lot of times you need to make it such that it's enjoyable inside the crate or enjoyable inside the playpen. So one way you can do is actually feeding the puppy inside the playpen and the crate. But the main thing is once they finish eating, they will look for the next thing to do. So to do crate training, you actually try not to use a football because the football will be done in 5 minutes. So the next tool that I can show you.
We have some really good questions in the chat, in the question and answer. So please do upvote if you want us to kind of prioritize the question and if everyone has the same issue so we can get to it.
I feel like a magician. I'm just like pulling things out of my head. Once again, if you just let me clean off the fur from this thing before I embarrass myself live on webinar. So the magical Kong. So Kong is fantastic. Really. I also feed Mira through Kongs. So the main thing about Kong is you freeze the kibble, or you freeze wet food, or freeze anything inside, and then you feed through the Kong. And that's how you encourage the puppy to enjoy the time inside the playpen. So you, let's think of a name. Let's just Mira. Mira, Mira, come here. And then Mira go into the playpen. Mira sit. Mira sit. And then I put a Kong in front of her. Mira stay. Then Mira go. Then Mira, you eat the Kong. And then when Mira's eating the Kong, I close the playpen. Then she's just eating the Kong there, and then she doesn't realize that the playpen is closed. And then usually because it's frozen, she'll take the time to lick. And then as she licks, the ice melts and the kibble comes off one by one, and then it takes her around maybe half an hour or so. And then once she's done, actually, then she will think about what to do next. Then it depends. Sometimes they will hang out inside for a while, they'll take a nap, things like that. But then the next thing is once she's, then if you want her to come out, you open the gate, and then she comes out. So I guess the next thing is, so the advantage of a Kong is actually when a dog is licking a Kong, the dog actually lies down. The dog lies down, both paws holding on the Kong, and then they start licking. So when the dog is lying down and then the kibble comes out one by one, what actually is conditioning the dog, like rewarding the dog for lying down. So rewarding the dog for being calm. So that's the beauty of a Kong. And then, so when Mira was younger, I used the smaller one. And now she grew up, so I got a bigger one. Yeah. So the big part of it is so, so back to the question about them, barking, you have to make the experience inside the playpen enjoyable for the puppy also. Yeah, and then the next thing is, if you are using the playpen to toilet train, then it's a different thing. Because you are sort of like waiting for the dog to pee and poo first. But if the dog doesn't want to pee and poo, then maybe that's not the right time. Yeah.
Okay. But for my personal experience, I don't know if, I think some might be able to relate. It's the opposite for me. So at night, that's when the puppy cries, when he's left in the pen. But in the day, he's okay with being left in the pen. So is it similar training?
So I guess in the day when the puppy is okay in the playpen, are you like around? Like, can the puppy see you?
Yeah.
Yeah. So the puppies are like cool. Then,
as long as he can see me.
Yeah. So for the puppy, then the puppy doesn't mind. Then at night, when the puppy is left inside the playpen, like, is everyone else in a different room already?
Yes.
Then for the puppies, like, hey, okay. Everyone go. Yeah. So I guess the advantage is so after a while, you can train them to get used to being alone also. So the big part is
so don't be around them too much in the day.
The advantage is the Kong trains them to be alone. So a big part of there's a webinar upcoming, I'm not sure when, about anxiety, where separation anxiety, where the dog is anxious when the owners are not around. And then a big part of it, the root of the problem is because for the dog, they're only confident, they get comfort from only the dog owner. So when the dog owner is not in the environment,
it's not there. Yeah.
And then they become anxious. So you, when you feed using a Kong and then you do crate training and things like that, then the dog actually gets comfort from other things in the environment at home.
Mm. And not just the owner.
Yes, okay. Exactly. Yeah.
And for the webinar that Dr. Chow mentioned with anxiety, that's upcoming on the 18th of October. That's actually our last webinar. Yeah. Okay, on to our next question. This one has a lot of votes. It's the highest now with 12 upvotes. So the question is, my puppy keeps peeing everywhere in the house, even though he knows where he's supposed to pee, but he just chooses not to go back to his pee tray and just pees wherever he likes. And when he poos, he likes to walk around and poo instead of staying in a position and poo finish first. May I know why that is? So I can relate to the pooing. Like, they'll leave like one trail. I don't know why he'll like slowly move while squatting. So I'm wondering the same thing as well. So Dr. Yeah. Chow, what do we do?
So toilet training, actually, the advantage for toilet training is you can train them anytime. Like, there's a 6-year-old dog coming to the house, you can still has quite good success during toilet training. And then, so I guess the comforting thing is eventually the dog will be toilet trained. But how long it takes depends on the individual dog. And then, so I guess the first thing about the dog pooing and walking around, there's a few different reasons. I guess the first thing is to make sure that the dog is not scooting. So the dog is not rubbing the bum against the floor. So rubbing the bum against the floor as they're pooping, or the big part of it is because due to intestinal worms. Then the next thing is also sometimes also when a puppy is too excited where he's trying to poop but there's something else getting his attention. Then he's trying to get this over done with so he can run there. And then, yeah, so I guess puppy is also like, sometimes puppy is just like distracted by everything. They want to play with everything and then they want to do everything at the same time. So I guess interesting thing is eventually they will stop doing that lah. But the main thing is also you need to train them. You need to reward them when they do it correctly. So a big part of dog training is that not so much scolding them and do it wrongly, but then rewarding them and letting them know they do it correctly. And then after a while, they will always do it correctly for you. Then there's a good segue to another book called Don't Shoot the Dog. So Don't Shoot the Dog is written by Karen Pryor. I mentioned Karen Pryor because she revolutionized clicker training. And then in Singapore, there's a few dog trainers who are Karen Pryor Academy trained. It's also a good way to figure out if they are force-free trainers. So talking about clicker training. Clicker training is also very advantageous because a big part of puppy or dog training is catching the correct timing. And then for you to communicate with the dog that's what you're doing right now is correct. Traditional way is giving the treat to the dog, but sometimes for you to open the container, take the treat, and then give the dog. And then the
very
dog was like,
yeah.
The dog was like, wait a minute, what did I do correctly? Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So the clicker training is because what you try and do is you associate the click sound to yes, that's the right thing. So it's easier for you. So the split second, first time the dog did the amazing poop by standing still, you click and then you run over and you celebrate doing a party with the dog. And then the first time the dog may not get it, but after a while the dog gets it. So I need to stand here and do a good poop. And then talk about peeing, right? There's a peeing part.
Yes, the peeing everywhere, even though they know where they're supposed to pee.
Yeah, so basically, a big part of it is when they are still very, very small, when they are still young, they don't associate the whole apartment as their home. That's why they will pee in that particular area. So interestingly, I'm just looking around my apartment now, it's because Mira used to pee in my living room because I trained Mira to pee in a toilet. So the toilet is near the kitchen. So Mira will pee in the toilet and then the kitchen would be her home. So she doesn't pee in the kitchen. But then everywhere else is still outside. So she'll pee outside. So the kitchen is like the forbidden area for her. The kitchen is always clean to her.
She kind of like marked it already.
Yeah, so she'll pee. So the tricky thing is when the environment is too, the surface area is too big, the dog cannot catch it. The dog doesn't understand that all this is part of her home. So that's why you need to do it in steps. You need to do it in steps to giving access to the dog. At the beginning, do it in phases. At the beginning, it's just a few square meters. And then slowly, as the dog learns, you will sort of level up the dog to open up the environment. So currently, right now, unfortunately, everywhere else to her is still considered as outside. Yeah, okay. Then a trick is actually what I've learned is how I managed to teach Mira to that the living room is actually also part of her home is what I learned from another dog trainer is that you feed her there. Because like humans, they would not pee and poo where they eat. Yeah, so wherever, I guess the main key thing, you make sure it's clean and then you start to feed some meals at a particular area and then slowly the dog will realize that, this is also part of my home where I need to keep clean also.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, so a big part of your dog of toilet training is patience, really. And eventually, the dog will get it. Because for me, I foster some of this. I foster elderly dogs that so pee and shit over the house. And then eventually they get it. They are really quite smart. Okay. Some frustration. And the main thing is there will be mistakes because they are not perfect. I mean, you think about babies or kids, they still wet a bit. So that when the mistake happen, scolding the dog makes the human feel better. But objectively, you need to think about why the mistake happened. Yeah, so one way or another, eventually you realize the mistake happened because the human did something wrong. For example, a few months ago, Mira peed at the wrong spot. And then I got a bit upset and I realized why. It's because I forgot to put, after I cleaned up the area, I forgot to put a pee pad down. So to her, so actually it was my fault, it's not her fault.
Yeah. I think a follow-up to your advice of using the clicker. So somebody asked if once they stop using the clicker, does the behavior, the bad behavior come back, or do they learn by a certain time after using the clicker? Or how can they sort of maybe phase out using the clicker when training?
I do phase out the clicker actually. So at the beginning, I train everything with the clicker. Then now, partly because I lost my clicker, but then I don't use it anymore. So I guess the big part of it is the clicker makes it a lot easier. So if you're struggling without a clicker, I highly recommend it. It's like $8 on Lazada. Yeah. And then, so if it's a lot easier, the clicker can really tell the difference.
Okay. And then I think a follow-up to the peeing and pooping, somebody said that the pup is trained most of the time, but when they are busy at home, the dog will purposely pee in front of them. So how do they stop it? So I think the pup knows where to pee, but only when they're busy. Is it like an attention thing? Mm. Probably.
So another big part, this comes down to another topic where sometimes people tell me that the dog does a rage poop. Like after I cut my dog's nails, my dog does a rich poop at the living room to throw his or her tantrum. I guess a big part of it is at the end of the day, dogs as incredible human beings, the dogs are incredible creatures. They do not have malicious intent. At the end of the day, they don't think about how to get back at you as the owners. So unfortunately, some way or another, doing the particular activity gets them what they want. So when they do a poop in the living room or they do a poop in front of you, they get what they want, which most of the time is your attention. Yeah. So to us, sometimes when the tricky part is like when you stand up and then you scold them and then you clean the shit or you clean the urine, and then to them they are getting your attention. So I guess even though you're scolding, the dog may not actually get it. So I guess for you to combat that is actually, it's not as straightforward, because if you want to stop the dog from peeing or pooping in the wrong spot, right, once they have already done it, it's a bit too late already. So you need to catch them in the act when they start squatting down, which may not be possible if you are like in the zone
at work.
So, but then the proper way of doing it is when you see them trying squatting down and you seem like they seem to be doing it, you need to break that pattern.
Okay.
So you break that pattern depending on what's easiest for you. Some people, they clap, or some people, they just stand up just to realize the dog, actually, I don't need to do this. Yeah. And then you bring them to the toilet because they have the urge to go to the toilet. So you stand up, you guide them to the toilet, and then when they do it there, and then you do a big celebration there, and then they realize, okay, actually I just need to go. As long as I do a good proper toilet activity at the correct space, the owner will still give them attention. Yeah.
They will get it after a while.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. And yeah, I've never met cats will be more tricky, but then dogs really did. Yeah, they really do get toilet training eventually. Okay. Yeah.
So just need to be more patient and consistent in the training.
Yeah.
Okay. I think we have one more question for this whole toilet potty segment, and then we can move on to another area. So another question that a lot of people are asking is, once they have already kind of pee-pad trained them at home, how do they transition or how do they start training to for their pets to be grass trained?
Yeah. So the interesting thing is, most of the dogs just get it because once their feet feels the substrate on the ground, it's a natural instinct to do it. But then if it's difficult, for example, some of the dogs like quite clean freaks. If they don't do it, you may actually need to, unfortunately, bring the pee pad downstairs to get them to, you get them used to it. And then you may need to catch the correct timing. So a lot of things to consider is such that if the dog has already recently peed already or recently pooed already, when you bring them down for a walk, they're not going to do it because there's nothing to come out anyway. Yeah. So so what you may need to do is that there's a lot of room for error. So it's a bit tricky. So you actually need to keep the pee pad first so that the dog doesn't poo on pee at home. But then before they make a mistake, you need to bring them down already. And then you bring the pee pad down with you.
So maybe how often will this be in a day?
That depends on how old the puppy is also. So the tricky thing is when the puppy is very young, like less than, okay, I'm assuming some, most likely it's an adult dog already because of our puppies, you're not supposed to bring them down when they haven't finished their core vaccines. So when usually if you're going to do them around when they are 5 to 6 months old, maybe you can do this 3-4 times a day, which has been impractical if you're working, to be very honest with you. Yeah, so, but I guess the key thing is that when you bring them down and they're getting used to peeing on the grass, the first few times is just pee pad on the grass. So they're peeing on the pee pad, but in the outdoors, so not on the grass at all. So you're trying to get the dog used to a lot of things, actually, if you think about it. Because you pee at home, right? It's a quiet environment.
Different environment, yeah.
Yeah, no one's going to disturb them. You get a nice, quiet shit. Sorry, pardon the language. But if you do it outside, it's like birds flying. There's like other dogs walking. There's humans walking around. You're trying to get them used to a lot of different things. So the first step is just trying to get them used to the environment first. And then the substrate is just pee pad. Yeah, at the end of the day, it's more of like breaking the particular activity to small different steps. And then trying to make it easy for them to do it. You can make it easy wins. A lot of times if you hit... like a brick wall, if you hit an obstacle, a lot of times because that particular step or transition is too hard for the dog. So you want to make it easy for them to win. Yeah. So I guess it's a principle to a lot of dog training stuff.
Okay. Yeah. I think that's a very probably common question from people here. I've also experienced it myself where when we go on a walk, the puppy will not pee and poop outside. And then once we come back, then he'll straight away go to the pee pad and So the trick is for the pee pad to bring it down.
Yeah, and so because there's too many things outside, and it's very hard to get used to it. Then when they do pee outside, regardless on the grass or on the pee pad, you have to celebrate with them. Really, a lot of times is to celebrate. Like, whoa, good dog! Then you give them treats. Depending on, sometimes they rather have the human attention and the encouragement than treats. So you have to see which one they really enjoy.
Prefer, yeah.
Yeah. So and then. Also a lot of times actually is if they're too excited by all the other stimuluses in the environment or they are fearful or anxious about all the things in the environment, they wouldn't do their toileting outside.
You have to make them calm first before
They have to be comfortable. I mean, like humans, there's some humans, let's say they take a bus to JB, they will not use the toilet until they reach the hotel room because they're not comfortable at all. So it's the same for the dog. Yeah.
Nice way to put it. Very relatable. I think everyone will remember that now.
Yeah.
Okay. Moving on from the whole toilet situation, hopefully we've answered most of the questions regarding that. Next one is on barking. So we have a lot of different varieties. So I'll just read out first the top voted question. So the question is, or rather comment is, my dog barks at the door, at the neighbor, delivery man, etc. How can I train that? I've tried the clicker method. SH shush pull method and pull away method, and nothing is working. So how do we go about that?
Yeah, so I guess the shush method is when just telling the dog to keep quiet. So I guess there's a few different ways of doing it. Probably the best way to do this is to help the dog understand that having someone at the door is actually a good thing. So it's not as easy because a lot of the dog training activities is not easy to do it as a single human being. You need multiple people to help you. So the first step is actually getting the dog realize that actually the door knock is something good. Yeah. So you need someone to stand outside and then you use your phone to coordinate. So you just ask the person to knock the door, and then once the person knocks the door, you reward the dog. So it's basically classical conditioning, and that's basically it. And then if it's difficult, in the sense that when you knock the door and then your dog ignores the food, ignores the tree, and just keep barking, basically it's the distance. Your dog need to be further away. So a lot of times, fear can be dampened by distance. Even similar for human beings, the further away is less scary. So you have to, a lot of things actually think about it. So the dog mainly be on a leash, so the dog doesn't walk away. So the owner and the dog stand a certain distance, and then someone knocking on the door, and then every time there's a knock, the owner gives a treat. Or the owner, it may be easier for you to ask as the owner to say, sit, good dog, and they give a treat. So having the sit first before the treat can also be helpful. Okay. Then as you can imagine, this is going to take 2 months to slowly
consistently to train,
so the dog slowly become nearer and nearer to the dog. Sorry, dog slowly become nearer to the door.
To the door, yeah.
Yeah, and then the knocking.
Huh. And for that, does the door have to be open or closed during that training?
Yes, so it really depends also. So sometimes it's easier with the door closed because when the door is closed, the human.
Mm.
And then I have scenarios where you actually need the door to be open, and there is a family member knocking the door. So the dog can see who is knocking the door, and the dog can see, okay, this person I know, this person I cool.
Mm.
Yeah, it's because sometimes the unknown of who is behind can also spook them out. So I guess how to try to think about it is, let's say there's something that's spooking a human baby out. How do you condition the human baby? Yeah, because a lot of you need to make it small little steps, really. Then a next part is actually there are certain anti-anxiety drugs that you can get from your vet to make it easier for you to speed things up. And then anti-anxiety drugs actually there's a wide variety, a wide spectrum. And then there are some where they have virtually no side effects, but then the anti-anxiety effects are mild. So I guess those usually will be the first tier you try. Because it just helps the dog to be a bit more chill, and then that's about it. And then usually as a vet, that's what I will give some dog owners if they are like visibly distressed and frustrated.
Mm.
Because a big part of it, dog training, right? It's part of it training the dog. Another part is also training the human being. So if the human being doesn't see progress, the human being becomes frustrated, the human being have a half-ass effort at trying all these things, it's not going to work also. So I do think that sometimes small easy wins, the dog owner feels like, hey, this is working, and then they can see it, and then they are more enthusiastic, and then it's a self-fulfilling prophecy, yeah, sort of.
More motivated to
Exactly.
Continue.
Yeah.
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 For this, for training in general, do you recommend that it should be just one family member doing the training, or can different people be training the puppy?
A lot of times, actually, you need two humans to do anything, to train anything. Unfortunately, it's very hard for even a single human being doing the training. It's possible, but I find it very challenging, even for myself. And then if you have two person, it's a lot easier. And then the advantage of that is also if you have multiple family members switching back and forth, that in itself is a kind of training for the dog. in a sense that they learn how to interact with other human beings. Because you don't want a dog that only listens to a single human.
One person. Yeah. That's so true. Okay.
So if you have strangers coming to the house, it's so important to be at the door handing out treats to the strangers. Not for the stranger. For the stranger to come in. And then when the stranger comes in, then the stranger, him or herself, yeah, sit. And then when the dog sits down, the stranger gives the treat. From the dog's point of view, the dog realizes actually meeting different human beings is actually
it's
a good
fun,
thing.
It's okay, yeah.
Yeah. So having different family members also is a good thing because you don't want where if the let's say the dog only listens to you and your sibling, what if you all go on holiday? What's going to happen?
Left with your parents and then doesn't listen to the parents.
Exactly. Okay. So you want everyone to be on board. At the end of the day, you're inviting a family member into your house. So as a family member, you need to learn the everyone in the family need to learn how to interact.
Okay. Yeah. But then obviously the commands and stuff has to be consistent that are used between family members, right? Because I from my experience, like I say sit, my parents say something else. Yeah. So I think that might be confusing, I think, for the puppy. Yeah.
It is confusing, but at the same time, the amazing thing is if each individual human being is consistent enough in a sense that one person says sit, the other person say the Chinese word zuo.
Yeah.
The amazing part is the dog eventually get it.
They will learn. Oh.
So for example, Mira, right? And Mira understands sit in sign language and the command also.
Oh wow. Okay.
Yeah. So there's no reason why I do it, but I just train Mira sign language in the sense that if I use hand gestures, Mira gets it.
Yeah.
So they understand multiple ways of they understand multiple instructions for the same command. So it's possible.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Then an interesting thing is when I bring my dog to work, my colleague, she's from China. She trains Mira to sit in Chinese.
In Mandarin, yeah.
In Mandarin, yeah. And then Mira gets it.
Okay.
So at the end of the day, unfortunately, they are really very smart. They're really very amazing. And then, unfortunately, sometimes when things screw up, it's because we screwed up, really. Yeah.
More on our side than the puppies.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that training, is it the same thing for barking at neighbors? Because there's a few questions also with regards to the puppy barking at neighbors.
Yeah. So I guess the big part then, comes down to another, I guess a lot of times when there's a certain question, I try to address the underlying principle because of dog ownership, dog training, people try to look for quick fix. Unfortunately, there's no quick fix. Even for human interaction, there's no quick fix. Human interaction, for someone to know and trust you, you need to build rapport, there's certain stages. It's the same for dog training, there's certain stages to understand the underlying principle. So why is the dog barking? The dog is barking because there's something distressful and then the dog is trying to alert the owners. So a big part of it is so we need to accept that dogs will always be dogs. The dog will bark and then the dog will growl, the dog will express themselves. Then as the owners, we don't want that behavior. There's certain things we can do to reduce that behavior. So as long as you understand that, then we can talk about the next part. Because for dogs, there are unwanted normal behaviors. So it's unwanted behavior in the home environment, but they are normal dog behaviors. So all these things you can, if you are struggling, you can get a dog trainer to help you with it. And then the different part is abnormal behaviors where it's abnormal even for a dog. And then unfortunately for those issues, very often you need actually medication to help the dog to overcome all these abnormal behaviors. So coming back to barking, right? So the dog will bark when they see the neighbor or they can hear the neighbor. Then as the dog, their reason for doing that is they find the presence of their neighbor stressful and then they want to let you know. And then a big part is, so some people, their knee-jerk reaction is they start to scold the dog. And then for the dog owner's point of view, the dog's point of view, it's like, the neighbor is here.
I'm just letting you know.
And then the owner starts scolding him.
Mm.
Then to him, there is a conditioning, that when the neighbor is here, my owner gets angry.
Mm.
And then that's when then it's a vicious cycle.
They link it to different things.
Yes. Really. Yeah. They, when the owner is here, as in when the neighbor comes in, my owner gets angry. So the, when the neighbor comes, I need to let my owner know because my owner's going to go bashing crazy.
Yeah.
So that's why scolding doesn't really help.
Okay.
Because they doesn't realize that you are scolding them because they are barking. They only thought that you're scolding them because the neighbor is here. Yeah. So
some barking is okay. Like,
so the big part of it is you need to stop. You need to address the barking by, there's two methods. Lah. So the shiz method helps where you address the concern. You get Fluffy. So let's say Fluffy is barking like crazy. Fluffy, come here. Then it depends on how far down you're in the training. Lah. So where let's start from the end goal in mind. So what you actually want is Fluffy come here, and then Fluffy comes. Then Fluffy has already done his mission of alerting you that the neighbor is back home. Then you say, good dog, Fluffy. Fluffy, sit. Then you give Fluffy a treat. So Fluffy has already achieved his mission.
Then he'll stop.
Yeah. Mm. And then that's what you want to achieve, where they will be barking, but only for like 2 to 3 seconds. Because he has already fulfilled his mission as the guardian of the house. Yeah. So they will be barking, but what you're trying to do is not extensive 15-minute barking at the poor uncle that is just outside the door.
Yeah.
So then how do you reach to that stage? Is that you need to address the anxiety also. So a big part of it is very similar to the knocking. And then the second thing is, because let's say the dog is extremely stressed and extremely angry at the uncle outside. If you're in the living room far away, if you call for Fluffy to come, Fluffy will not come to you. So I guess because there's different factors here. One is actually the further away you are from the dog, the less control, in a sense that the less likely they'll listen to your command. So you yourself may need to stand nearer to the dog.
Stand close by. Okay.
Yeah. And then you need something that actually, other treats near me, something that actually from the cost-benefit analysis, they rather come to you than barking at the owner. Mm. Yeah. Okay, so as I elaborate, it's more and more it's actually quite a complex issue. There's a lot of things at play right here. So a lot of things actually the owners comes down to you. So you actually need to train distant command. Like when you are far away from the dog, because the dog still listens to you. So for example, when you ask the dog to sit, when the dog is just right in front of you, will the dog do that? Hands down, 10 out of 10, yes. Then if you step 1 meter apart, 2 meters apart, 3 meters apart, the likelihood of a dog sitting will drop. This actually is scientifically proven. What you can do is actually to train your dog to be still willing to listen to you when you're far away. This is without external stimulus. Only when you can get this under control, then you can talk about getting Fluffy to come to you when there's something outside that's distracting him.
Oh, yeah. I see. So is this also similar training? Is it to, example, overexcited dogs outside? Like when they're bringing their puppy for a walk and then they're very excited with seeing other puppies or other external stuff.
Yeah. So.
Yeah.
Sort of. Not really. Let me think about it. So let's say the dog. The dog is chased. Let's say one sees a bird, they want to chase the bird. It's a different trigger. But I guess it's useful in the sense that let's say you're at a dog park, and then you want your dog to come back to you. And then let's say the dog is chasing another dog, and then chasing another dog is infinitely more exciting than coming back to you. That's why they're not coming back to you. Yeah. So you need to make it such that even without any external stimulus, nothing else that's more attractive in a home environment where it's like a close environment and they are willing to come back to you, that have to be achieved first. Yeah. So I guess the interesting thing, what I try to do is from far, I get Mira to do commands when I'm like 10, 12 meters away from her. Sit down, stand, you might make sure that she's willing to do that when you are quite far away.
Further away, yeah.
Yeah, and then so a big girl go back to barking at the owner, barking at the neighbor outside. So big, so it's not that straightforward, lah, but it's definitely achievable. And then if you're really struggling, you really get a dog trainer. If you're really struggling, you can get some anti-anxiety medicine to speed things up for you. I guess for me, because I'm a vet, and then there are some times that I do use the anxiety medicine to make it easier for both me and Mia, lah, to be very honest with you. And so far, quite good success, lah. So I guess then...
of course, try the steps that you've mentioned first.
At the end of the day, it's very, very small little steps. And at the end of the day also, it may not... The external trigger in itself is hard to get a neighbor to help you, I think, unless it's a bit...
They're willing to.
What you can do is actually get a friend or relative to play the neighbor. Just stand outside. So
just to help,
So the living room, from the lift lobby, you just stand a bit nearer, doing steps.
Yeah.
And then as you can tell, gradually, this is actually quite a big project. It's not as straightforward.
Okay.
Because what I'm trying to do now is trying to do a dog, try to teach the dog something that we want, but it's unnatural to the dog.
To them, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So moving on from barking now, we're into biting. I think we have, time is almost up, so we'll try to speed through the next question. So biting. So my puppy keeps on biting me even when I pet him, even though I try to distract with the chew toy. How do I stop him?
So what I'm talking about is now is bite inhibition, really. So the big part of bite inhibition is really when they use their teeth to interact with you, they bite you. There's two things you need to do. One is actually you need to... So when it's another dog, the other dog will scream and run away. The other puppy. So what you can do is also the same thing. So basically, it sounds ridiculous. Basically, you need to vocalize, like you say ouch or ow, in a loud way where the puppy just take a step back and then just look at you. And then they will stop. So they realize they cannot bite you. And when the puppy does what they want, when the puppy does what we want, which is the correct, at the end of the day, you need to give a dog a way to interact with you. So if they cannot bite you, what's the next thing they can do that is safe? Is to lick you. So when they lick your hand, and then that's when you praise him or her.
Mm.
So you try and tell her that licking is the way to go, biting is not.
Mm. Okay.
And then if the puppy is out of control, that's where you do the next step, where the pup, you need to leave the room. You need to break that contact. And then the puppy realizes, if I want to play with my owner, I cannot go batshit crazy.
Mm.
I cannot keep biting them. So a lot of times, when the puppy goes crazy, you keep biting, then I see the owners, oh, cute dog, good dog, and then their hands have so many wounds. So actually, no, really, you need to stand up and then you need to leave the room.
Mm.
And then the puppy realized, okay, I can, for me to continue playing my owner, I need to be more gentle, I need to lick them.
Okay.
Yeah. So basically, this is all bite inhibition training. So it's very, very important, really, because... how to put it, a lot of problems we see when they're older could have been prevented if there was a bite inhibition done properly
training
when they were
done,
younger.
Yeah.
Yes, really. And then there's so much things you can do. And then I saw another thing that caught my eye, talk about growling.
Mm.
I can teach you a concept where a lot of times when dogs growl, a lot of owners actually scold their dog. Like that. And then there's a concept called the gift of the growl. So the growl is actually a beautiful thing. So let me just explain myself. So at the end of the day, the dog needs to learn how to communicate with the world, need to learn how to communicate with the owners. And then barking, growling, all things are ways for the dog to express themselves. And then if you take that away from them, it can be potentially dangerous. So let's say when the dog is in an uncomfortable environment, when the dog, let's say a stranger comes to your dog and then the stranger tries to pet your dog and then your dog starts to growl. Basically, your dog is trying to say, hey, wait a minute, dude, you're too close. And then that's when the dog owner to recognize that your dog is uncomfortable. Then you tell, then you have to step in. Tell the person to wait a while. Can you take a step back? That's one interaction, right? What you just did was you minimized a potential accident. But if you take away the growl, what happens is that you take away the ability for the dog to express themselves, and then a lot of times the dog just goes from A to B, which is nothing to I bite you to defend myself. So a lot of times, if you scold your dog for growling, the dog realizes that I cannot growl. So I can only go from nothing to bite straight away.
Yeah.
It's actually very, very dangerous if you think about it. So when a dog growls, you recognize actually the dog is asking for space. And then a lot of injuries that we see when people get bitten is because the dog somehow or another has learned not to growl because they got scolded for growling. And then
growling,
It's very, very dangerous. Especially we see in vet clinics where people get bitten. So the proper way actually when a dog growl is your dog express their discomfort. You need to stop the interaction, and then you need to call your dog to you if the dog is far away, and then you have to actually praise the dog for being confident enough to express their feelings. And then actually, if you can, if the tree is nearby, you ask them to sit and reward them for that. So you have to really encourage your dog to express themselves, because if they hide their feelings, if they become introverts, it's very dangerous. Because for even for human beings, right, some people they keep everything to themselves, and one day it explodes.
Yeah.
And then for a human to explode, it's not too bad. But then for a dog to explode, this can be dangerous. Yeah.
Okay.
So if you want to read more about this, you can just Google GIF of the growl. And then there's a lot of content about that, a lot of training about that also.
Build on from there. Okay, yeah. Thanks for that. All right, so I think we're coming to our last question. And I think it's quite interesting. So the question is, why does my dog eat his own poop, and how do I stop him from doing so?
How was the dog?
Is this a common thing?
Yeah, so a big part of this is eating poop in itself can be... It's sometimes a normal behavior. Sometimes it's eating it because of some medical issue. So I guess the big part is the most common issue for puppies is intestinal worm. So you just make sure that you brought your puppy to the vet recently to get the puppy dewormed. And then the next part is that the puppy eating poop could be due to a few reasons. One is boredom, one is anxiety, and the other one is also nutritional imbalance. Talking about nutrition first is easier. So a lot of times, puppies need to make sure that you feed them commercial puppy kibble and not home cooked diet or any other diet. One common thing that I commonly see in private practice is that puppies on home cooked diet or non commercial diet is that their bones do not develop properly. And what happens is that they break their bones very easily. So I've seen before, two puppies, they are fostered. And then they're playing at home. Then suddenly, after they play, one of them starts to limp and cry. And then when you take x-rays, right, you just realize that the bones were very thin. And then the thin bones just cracked when they were tumbling around. And then it's because that they were not fed a balanced diet. Balanced in the sense that the proportion and the ratio of the minerals, calcium, phosphorus, selenium, 10,000 things are all properly done, which is very, very difficult if you are not a veterinary nutritionist. And so easy way about that is to just feed puppy kibble when they're puppies to make sure they grow properly. So if it's not a nutritional thing, it could be anxiety, behavior is anxiety or boredom. So boredom can be tackled by all the environmental enrichment things that I showed you just now, which is somewhere here. And then next step is also clearing the poop as soon as it comes out, which sometimes may not be practical and feasible, but that is actually the easiest way. An advantage is also a lot of dogs grow out of it, to be honest with you. So hopefully your dog's one of them. But if your dog is not, then you really have to do the proper training where you have to clear the poop as soon as possible. Yeah. Another thing is also training your dog to poo on pee on cue, which is very advantageous. So that's easier for you to do everything else. When someone's talking about training your dog to poo and pee outside, it's a lot easier when you can teach them to poo and pee on cue. And then talking about getting the shush method, which is touching the kid quiet, it's a lot, easier if you teach your dog to bark on cue or growl on cue. Yeah. So actually, teaching them to bark and growl on cue seems counterintuitive, but actually very important. Yeah. So then that's when you can actually teach them to be quiet on cue, because otherwise you can't teach them to be quiet.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then so I guess talking back to pooping, eating that poop, just make sure it's not a medical reason, not a nutritional reason, and then it's not due to boredom. Anxiety wise, and then you need to figure out where the anxiety is coming from.
Mm.
And then let's say every time they eat their poop, and then you start scolding them or you start running to them, then you may actually be rewarding them for eating their poop.
Mm, okay. Just check how they are behaving and responding to what's happening. Okay.
Yeah. And then another thing is also need to keep in mind that it's actually normal for dogs to eat some poop also.
Ah, I see. I did not know that.
Yeah. So as puppies, some of them eat, because as puppies, when they're still developing their gastrointestinal tract, they do not have the proper bacteria flora in their intestines. So there's a theory among some scientists is that when they eat their poop, they try to adjust the bacteria in their stomach, in the intestines. So at the beginning, eat some is normal. And then, to us, it's unwanted behavior. Because after they eat the poop, they start licking your hand, they start licking your face. It's not really hygienic. Yeah, so clearing them the soonest is the easiest method.
Okay.
And then eventually you break the cycle because they can't even do it.
Yeah.
Physically impossible. Yeah.
Mm. Okay. Well, I think that's all the time that we have now. So thank you very much, Dr. Chow. I think we've all learned a lot of really good tips to take away with us.